Sometimes I think that's a little too close. This morning we're picking back up in 1 Peter. A few of us men have been tasked to cover this book throughout the quarter, so we're taking different turns. Barry did a great job the last two class periods, and we're picking back up in 1 Peter, the second half of 1 Peter 1. Before we begin our class, I've asked Kyle to lead us in a word of prayer, if he would.
Things that we find in it, that we can study them, and that we can apply them in our lives so that we can serve you, that we can spread your word. And Father, we're humbled at the love that you've shown us. We pray that we can always remember that we can take it, that we can show that to others, that we can serve you, and that we can serve one another. Pray that you'll be with us as we enter into this study. Help us to focus on the things that we find in your word. Pray that you'll be with the teacher. Help him to remember the things he's prepared. And we pray that we can all be active participants in this class. Thank you most of all for your son and the sacrifice he made for us and the love that was shown to us. And we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Kyle, thanks for that. All right, if you've got an outline, you can see we've got quite a bit of information to get through. If you don't, is there someone that's grabbed some extras? I think we're making some copies. We'll get right on time. Joe's got some copies. If you want to raise your hand, he'll come and get those to you. We've got quite a bit of information to get through. Peter definitely did not leave us wanting for more information or more scripture to use here. What a great letter he's written. And to recap just for a few seconds, Barry did such a great job the last 2 weeks and definitely did a phenomenal job introducing what this letter is about, who Peter was, who he's writing to, and the main point. But I think as we continue, I just want to remind us what the main point of this book is, and that's of a message of comfort to the Christians that were scattered in the different regions that he listed. And it's a message of comfort because they're going through various trials, he says. If they're not going through various trials now, then they will be with some of the persecution that is going to be upcoming. We know through history, Emperor Nero was a very tyrannical emperor. He was very harsh to the Christians, and this was written during his reign. So if they weren't yet going through the persecution that would be brought on by Nero, it's coming up soon. And Peter knows that as Christians, they'll be targeted. And so he's writing to them of a hope that takes them beyond this world, something they can fix their minds to, something they've been promised to help comfort them and put them at ease, to let them know the struggles they'll go through is all worth it. And that's the main key behind this book. And as each of us men teach these classes upcoming, keep that in the back of your mind. It might help make things a little bit more clear as to what Peter is specifically talking about. Again, in verses 1 through 12 of 1 Peter, so we're picking up in 1 Peter chapter 1. And Barry covered that, verses 1 through 12. In the rest of the chapter, Peter goes on to, again, elaborate on the great gift of salvation that Christians have been given and the great impact on their lives that it should have. Peter does a great job of using repeating words and themes, which is nice because I'm a simple-minded kind of guy. I like to think. I like to pick up on patterns. It's easy to pick up on patterns. And so I've got a box there that has some words and ideas that Peter often repeats. As we've seen in verses 1 through 12, there'll be some words and ideas that pop back up in today's lesson and then again in Wednesday night's lesson and throughout the rest of the book of 1 Peter. Love, grace, salvation, obedience, living hope, children, glory, the idea of gold and silver, blood of the Lamb, and then the revelation of Jesus are just a few to name some of the ideas that he repeats. As we go through this first lesson today, we're going to cover 1 Peter 13 through 25. We'll read just a few verses here in a minute, but there's three main ideas that I've gone through and divided this section of Scripture up into. The first one is 1 Peter 1, verses 13 through 16. And that's the responsibility of a Christian to live a holy life. The next section is verses 17 through 21, and that's the redemption of a Christian's life. And then the last part is verses 22 through 25, and that's the reassurance offered to Christians. So those are the main overarching themes of this section. And then we'll go back, we'll start now and start to dive into those a little bit more specifically and take out some of the message that Peter's given to us. So starting in 1 Peter 1, verses 13 and 16, this picks up after Peter introduces the idea of the Christian's hope through Christ in the first 12 verses. Like we said, he continues in this next section of Scripture to dive to give a deeper instruction to the Christians. Here he advises them to live their lives by a certain set of standards. Let's read that couple of verses really quick, picking up in verse 13. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Keep sober in spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Peter uses some amazing terminology and words. He uses some very specific words, powerful words. And just in those couple verses we read, we've already picked up on a few of the repeating themes from verses 1 through 12 that Barry covered. And what the points I have listed here, again, I asked you guys, if you have an outline, if you had a chance to go over that, to list why each of these might be important, but I wanted to highlight the importance of some of the words that he uses. So starting in verse 13, he starts with the instruction for the people to live soberly. That's a strong word to me. Sober, that's a word that maybe we don't use as much in today's life as we should. Usually it's only used when we're talking about alcohol or drinking, but this is a word that he uses that goes beyond that. It goes into the idea of having self-discipline, keeping your mind set on what you're doing, having self-control mentally and spiritually. Does anybody have a King James version? I'm sure we have some people here. Does any of you, it says, gird your loins. You guys see that? I'm sure we're all familiar with that phrase, but gird your loins. As Peter's giving the charge for the people to keep their minds sober, he also tells them to fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you. And in the King James, he uses the phrase to gird your loins. Has anybody heard that phrase before or knows what that means? Probably 50-50, we were familiar with that. So gird your loins. So in that time period, the people wore robes, loose clothing that was around their legs, more of like a, I would say a dress or a kilt, but that kind of idea. And so imagine trying to run in that. If something came up, an urgent matter came up, and you had to flee from an animal or an enemy came at you, you had to run pretty quick. That's going to be pretty tough to run in sandals and the stress that's, or this garment that's around your legs. And so what gird your loins means is they would take that garment, they would, I don't even want to imitate it because I'm going to look kind of silly not having one on, but to put it through their legs, and they'd kind of come across with it, and then tied around their waist. And so they'd take up that dress, they'd make it tighter, and they'd prepare themselves for action. And that was the whole idea of girding your loins, to prepare yourself for action. And that's what the picture that Peter is painting here is, to prepare yourself. There's something that's going to be upcoming. There's things that you guys are going through, these trials. You need to prepare yourselves. You need to keep a sober mind, a strong mind in what's going on. And you need to prepare yourselves. The second part of that verse, fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Again, my translation, I'm reading from the New American Standard. Mine uses the word fix. And again, I think that's another strong word that Peter uses. Not just to set, not just to think on something, but to fix. To fix it firmly, to set it 100% in. the phrase that we use today that comes to my mind is to, you're fixed on a goal. Your mind is set, is fixed on that. It's clearly focused. You have a goal in your mind, and that's what you're going after. And that's the idea that he's giving to the people here. And what are they to be fixed in? What does it say they're supposed to be fixed in? The grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Anybody have any thoughts on what Peter's referring to by the revelation of Jesus Christ and what that grace might be? If we set a goal, if we fix our minds on a goal, is that all we have to do? No. And that's, you have to work at it. You have to prepare for it. You have to organize, and then you have to execute on that. So that's a good point. Yes. Sarah?
I feel like a lot of these two points are both about being intentional and kind of about fixing your mind. You may put an address in your GPS to go somewhere or pick a point on the map and figure out how you're going to get where you're going. But if you don't constantly keep an eye on where you're going, you might end up in a ditch somewhere. You might take a wrong turn. Like if, just like driving a car, you're constantly adjusting your course to get to that goal. And it's not something you can just set and just cruise. There's action that has to happen along the way.
Right. And as we get through this this section and even the next section and the section after that, that's an underlying theme of both what you just shared is to, we have to have action, but we have to stay focused on that and have an intent to do that. And that's the underlying theme that Peter is giving to them. And he'll start to explain that more. So we'll cover that point more. So thank you for that. Yes. Thanks for clarifying that, yes. Yep. So he's instructing them to have a sober mind, to ready their mind. In verse 14, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lust which were yours in your ignorance. That's a packed verse right there. There's a lot in that. You have any parents in the crowd today? Quite a bit. As obedient children, what would happen if you guys didn't lead your children? Be chaos, probably, right? They do whatever they wanted to do. Peter uses the idea of children repeatedly, describing the Christians here. And again, this is another repeated theme that we'll touch on more later in this lesson and then on Wednesday. But children, we all know, are led, and they need to be led to be brought up in life correctly. They need to be taught. If we just let them do what they want to do, that's going to be chaos. They're going to live such a horrible life, they're not going to come up how they need to, and that's not doing them any service. And us as the children of God, we're no different. God is there leading us. It's our responsibility, as what Peter's telling them here, to be obedient children. He tells them not to be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance. So he's referring to their lives before they obeyed the gospel, before they were baptized and put on the name of Christ. He says, don't go back to those. There's no reason. You need to be obedient to the gift that's been given to you in your ignorance. Don't be ignorant and go back to your former ways of your life. Joe. We definitely don't know everything, do we? And it takes time. It's going to take the studying to do that. This section reminds me of another scripture in Romans 8:14. You don't have to turn there for sake of time, but Romans 8:14, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. And of course, that correlates to us and all those who put on the name of Christ. But he's charging them to be obedient. He's trying to tell them the ways that they need to live, again, so they can continue to partake in this gift of salvation that's been promised to them. In verse 16, he changes up. He doesn't change up, but he continues with telling them to be holy. Because it is written, "You shall be holy, for I am holy." I think growing up, I always thought the word holy meant to be perfect. We had the idea of, man, God is a holy God. If I'm going to compare to that, if I'm going to understand that, holy, God is, I can't be like God. God, holy to me was always a word that meant perfectness in spirit, sinless. Here in this verse, that's not quite the message that he's portraying. What do we think holy means? What do we think Peter's trying to state with the word holy? The point he's trying to get across. Perfectness?
Set apart.
Set apart, right. We're familiar with that. So to set apart themselves from the rest of the people around them, to the rest of the sin that's going on. He just told them to get away from their ignorant childhood lusts and ways of their life. Remove yourselves from sin. Now you must become holy in the fact that you are separating yourselves from the rest of the world. There it is. There's a great correlation right there. And even in, I can't say much more on that. We're supposed to separate ourselves from sin. We live around it. We're not supposed to shelter at home and never come in contact with it. That's going to be impossible, but we're supposed to live our lives in a way that's separate. He's telling the Christians here to do the same thing, to separate yourselves from that. Don't go back to your old ways, but to separate yourselves and distinguish yourselves from the rest of the world. The idea of becoming holy, one might ask, how do we do that? We can use what Peter wrote back in chapter 1, verse 2, to understand that just a little bit better. We can spend a lot of time, we can go off in a different direction talking about holiness and how we're made holy, but I think as a simple answer, a simple point to be made, if you look at verse 2 in chapter 1, Peter says, according to the foreknowledge of the God of the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit. So by the Holy Spirit, by coming to Jesus, by being baptized through the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit, we are made holy. And we should continue to keep ourselves holy and separate from the rest of the world. Jonathan. And that's exactly what we're getting to kind of close out this first section of Scripture. Again, Peter is telling them, you've been given this perfect gift of heaven, this amazing everlasting gift. You're going to be going through trials. He's trying to set their minds in the future. He's trying to set their minds not on, like just what Jonathan said, not what's here today, but you have this gift of heaven that's been offered to you. Set your minds on that. It's going to help you get through these trials. And that's a great summation of this section of Scripture. We can see Paul in the letter to the Romans in Romans 12, verses 1 through 2. He actually mimics, he mirrors exactly what Peter is saying in a couple different ways he does that. He summarizes what Peter says in verses 1 through 2. Romans 12, 1 through 2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect his perfect will. So everything Peter said, we see that in Paul's letter to the Romans as well, just phrased a little bit differently. And so it's good to see them mirroring that same idea of this is how you need to live your life, to please God. This is how you need to live your life to set yourselves apart from the world. And this is what it's going to take to eventually, after this earthly life is over, to be in heaven with God. Getting down to the question here, so a little bit of an application. Peter's told the Christians in this time how to live their lives. We've looked at that. What are some things in our lives that commonly distract us from living this way? What often gets in the way of us having a sober mind in what we do? What gets in the way of having of us living our lives and forgetting our childish ambitions and lusts and silliness? What are some things that distract us from living that way?
TV does
that. Especially today, TV is horrible.
Hobbies.
That's the second one I had listed, was hobbies.
And sometimes it's just family that you don't get outside the family to engage with other Christians.
Right. Right. Anything else? Other thoughts?
Being selfish.
Okay. I have that as well, being selfish, not spending enough time in God's word or with other fellow Christians. I view that as being selfish, right? What are some ways that we can help ourselves become better focused in living how we should? That's what I had. Get in the word. Spend more time in the Bible. Spend more time with Christians. Spend more time focusing on God's word and sharing it with others. David? And Peter goes on to talk more about that. That's I don't want to take away from Todd. I wanted to talk more on that, but again, Todd will cover that in one of his lessons. That's another underlying theme of the book of 1 Peter, is that he's telling the people, you're not going to be here for forever. You guys are just passing travelers. Your time here on this earth is fleeting. You have something so much better to look forward to. Live your lives how I'm telling you to. Sarah? Right, and that's a good point. And in the question, I used the word distraction. I think that's where my mind was too, is that today it's much more of a distraction. We have many more distractions than the people had persecutions back in the day. And we can distinguish, you know, how the devil works in different ways, and he uses both of those to his advantage, persecutions and distractions, to distract us and keep us away from God's word. So, good point. We got time for one more comment. Yes. All right, moving on. In the next section of scripture I mentioned, that was 1 Peter 1, 17 through 20, 21. As we see, Peter's detailed how the Christians should live. He explains why it's important to live such a holy life. Their lives were bought with such a high price. Because of the price paid, if they live an obedient life, their salvation is guaranteed and they won't be disappointed in it. Let me read verses 17 through 21 quickly here. If you address as Father the one who impartially judges according to one's work, conduct yourselves in fear during the time of your stay on earth, knowing that you are not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life, inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood as of a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. For he was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but has appeared in these last times for the sake of you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. I kind of wish Peter would have flip-flopped this section with the last section of Scripture. Here he's telling the people, sorry about that, he's telling the people, y'all have been bought with something extremely precious. In verse 18, your souls were bought with imperishable gifts. In the last section, he's telling them to the certain way that they should live to be able to have access to that gift. So if he would have flip-flopped that, maybe that would have been a little bit easier to understand and follow. But he picks up telling them to live in fear of a God that judges each one impartially. But not just impartially, according to each one's own work. And to me, that's such a beautiful thing that our God does that. I think back on that thought often, that my salvation isn't dependent upon Corey's salvation, isn't dependent upon Sarah's salvation. It is all dependent on the works that I do, the work that I put into this life, and living as an obedient child, and how well I live with a sober mind. That's what my salvation hinges on. I played team sports and growing up, and oftentimes I wasn't always on the best team. You get stuck on a team with some pretty bad players, and you're dependent upon their performance to help your team win. That's why I like track, because track was more of an individual sport, so I can go out and I can, whatever I did, however I performed, that was completely on me. And our salvation is the same way. That's what Peter's saying here, that God judges each one of us according to our own works. Verse 18, he continues, their souls were bought with an imperishable gift. Again, he reuses the word imperishable here. He mentions gold and silver because that's what the people are going to understand. They understand gold and silver. They buy things on a daily basis. They trade things. Gold and silver was very valuable to them. But he's saying you've been bought with something that's extremely more important and valuable than gold and silver. You've been bought with an imperishable gift. If we look at, you can look at Leviticus 18, you don't have to turn there, but just as a thought, the high priests at the time in this section were commanded by God to redeem the firstborn male babies, both human and of unclean animals, that were given and offered to the Lord. They were to do that for a price of 5 shekels. And so as these firstborn were given to the high priests for an offering to the Lord, those high priests were in turn to redeem them for 5 shekels. So we even have some mosaic example there of maybe what it means to redeem, the price of redemption. And so some of the Jews that Peter's talking to would have understood that. They would have understood the idea of being bought and redeemed for a certain price. But again, Peter says, that's not the case here. You've been bought with an imperishable gift. One that nothing else can touch. One that nothing else, no other gift, not even one from your the habits and the traditions of your forefathers can buy your souls with. And so tying that back to living such a high standard above, if you've been bought with such a high price, it makes sense why he's charging them to live to a high standard, to live and to be holy as God is holy, does it not? Verse 19 continues talking more about the currency with which they were bought. They were bought with precious blood, the blood of a spotless lamb, unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. To me, that's a clear Passover reference. We talked about that in our class preparing for this. That's just a clear Passover reference. So any of the Jews that he was talking to, they'd understand that. They were charged with finding a spotless and unblemished lamb to offer for the Passover feast. Again, that's something that doesn't, you can't just go out and do that. You have to plan for that. You have to have care and thought that's put into that. You have to take care of your flock and to make sure that come time for Passover, you have a spotless and an unblemished lamb to offer. I can't imagine trying to, I don't even know how to do that. Ron, I think Ron's here. Ron, you raise chickens. Do you have any spotless or unblemished chickens that you know of? Do you have any idea how to raise a spotless or an unblemished chicken? I have no idea. I'm sure somebody here might have an idea, but I do not. So the idea there is that it takes forethought. It takes effort to be able to give an unblemished lamb. And so what Peter is telling the people here is that God has put effort into the sacrifice that he's given for your souls, for your redemption. It is the costliest gift that could be given. God in the flesh was given. And that reminds me of 1 John 1:29. The Lamb of God taketh away the sin of the world. Easy correlation there. Peter continues in verse 20. Christ's sacrifice was planned before the foundation of the world. Just as it took effort and planning and care, or not just as, it took that. But we're told that God had this in plan and in motion before humans were even in existence. Before he even created the world, God had the plan of salvation written. He had it figured out, and he was putting it in motion even before the beginning of the world. I think of another scripture, John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We'll talk more about the Word in the next section here, but keep that scripture in mind. And then fifthly in this section, Peter tells the people to keep their hope in God's promise through Christ in verse 21. Who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Again, he uses the same ideas of faith, of hope, believers in God. And it's a God that has overcome the grave, he says. He reminds them that you are put into this salvation, not just in any wooden or man-made God that is around you, one that could blow over with the breeze and couldn't even pick itself up, like many of the idols of the people at the time. But you're born into a God that has been sacrificed, that's gone to the grave and has overcome death and has been resurrected. And through that is the promise that God has given to us through his Son. He promises salvation, that home in heaven, through the belief of the people that they believe in Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, that he is a God that has overcome the grave. Again, in Wednesday night's lesson, we'll talk more about that foundational belief of who Christ is and that he's a part of God's plan. But for now, that's the main idea. 1 Corinthians 15:12-19 gives us a different perspective on that. If Christ wasn't raised, then our preaching is in vain. And 1 John 14:1-7, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. If you had known me, you should have known my Father also. Getting to our question there, what do you think fearing God should look like in our lives? Uh-oh. Thoughts on that? What should fearing God look like in our lives? Reverence is the key, and Charlie, that's essentially what you're saying, but we should be reverence in our relationship with God. Just like my mom used to tell me, and I'm sure many of your moms would tell you, I brought you into this world, I can take you out of it. But God is the one who has definitely put us into this world, and he could take it all away from us. And in that, we should have a reverence of him. That should be our fear in him. We should go to him with great respect, and we should love him. We should put him first in our lives because of that. 100%. Right, 100%. Peter charges us to be obedient children, and so we know we're supposed to be a part of God. We're supposed to stay a part of him. We're to be holy like him, and so that's a good thought as well. We should be fearful of being separate from him. Joe?
This part of the text right here, to me, kind of emphasizes two things very strongly. You know, one is that if we're to be the people of God, we have to be holy as he is. We have to take on his character. But at the same time, we can't work our way into heaven. We can't do enough works to equal what God has given us. We see that we have to change our lives here, but what we also see is God's grace. Something else that becomes a very important part of this passage. We have to change our lives, and we want to change our lives because of what he's called us, because of his grace. And I think that's a point that needs to shine here.
Right. Thanks. Good point. Got just a few minutes left here in the last section, 22 verses 22 through 25. Peter gets into the reassurance offered to the Christians in this salvation. He's explained to them the redemption and why it's important, and thus then why they should live their lives obediently. Here he offers reassurance that salvation they've been promised is everlasting and will never fade. Picking up in verse 23, for you have been born again, not of the seed which is perishable, but imperishable, that is, through the living and enduring word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, and the flower falls off, but the word of the Lord endures forever, and this is the word which was preached to you. He uses the word quite a bit there, the word quite a bit there. It's kind of important. That's the message he's getting at, is how strong and important the word of God is there. And he calls it the living seed. The word is the living seed. What are some thoughts on that? What do we think the living seed might mean? If you replace the word with Jesus, it all means the same thing. It means even more at that point. Jesus is living forever. He'll never die. He's overcome the grave. And because of that, we also will live forever if we're obedient to him. And that's the whole point here, that we are bought, we are saved with an imperishable living seed and an imperishable living gift, which is Jesus. And he's telling the people here that that's your hope. That's what you can believe. That's what you can hang on to. In this time of trial, what I'm telling you to grasp onto will never fade. Any of the pain, the punishment, the trials you'll go through, you can hang on to this and know it's not ever going to go anywhere. Because he's already overcome the grave, and God's given him, and he's here and will be everlasting. And so that's, just for lack of time, the section, that last section in the summary. And that's why he put such a big emphasis on the word of God, because that's his gift to the people through his son. Thanks for your participation. We'll pick up Wednesday. I believe we have the outlines out in the foyer for Wednesday's class.